At this point, let me remind you of another of the important jobs that was assigned to Schiff when he was dispatched to America. I refer to the job of destroying the unity of the American people by creating minority group and racial strife. By the pogrom-driven Jewish refugees into America, Schiff was creating one ready-made minority group for that purpose. But the Jewish people, as a whole, made fearful by the pogroms, could not be depended upon to create the violence necessary to destroy the unity of the American people. But right within America, there was an already made-to-order, although as yet a sleeping minority group, the Negroes, who could be sparked into so-called demonstrations, rioting, looting, murder, and every other type of lawlessness. All that was necessary was to incite and arouse them. Together, those two minority groups, properly maneuvered, could be used to create exactly the kind of strife in America the Illuminati would need to accomplish their objective. Thus, at the same time that Schiff and his co-conspirators were laying their plans for the entrapment of our money system, they were also perfecting plans to hit the unsuspecting American people with an explosive and terrifying racial upheaval that would tear the people into hate fractions and create chaos throughout the nation, especially on all college and university campuses, all protected by Earl Warren decisions and our so-called leaders in Washington. Of course, perfecting those plans required time and infinitely patient organizing. Now, to remove all doubts, I'll take a few moments to give you documentary proof of this racial strife plot. First of all, they had to create leaderships and organizations to draw in millions of dupes, both Jewish and Negroes, who would do the demonstrating and commit the rioting, looting, and lawlessness. So in 1909, Schiff, the Laymans, and other conspirators organized and set up the National Association for the Advancement of the Colored People, known as the NAACP. The presidents, directors, and legal counsels of the NAACP were always white men, Jews appointed by Schiff. And this is the case to this very day. Then, in 1913, the Schiff Group organized the Anti-Defamation League of the B'nai B'rith, commonly known as the ADL, to serve as the Gestapo and hatchet man outfit for the entire Great Conspiracy. Today, this sinister ADL maintains over 2,000 agencies in all parts of the country, and they advise and completely control every action of the NAACP, or of the Urban League, of all the other so-called Negro civil rights organizations throughout the nation, including such leaders as Martin Lucifer King, Stokely Carmichael, Bayard Rustin, and others of that ilk. In addition, the ADL acquired absolute control of the advertising budgets of many department stores, hotel chains, and TV and radio industrialist sponsors, also advertising agencies, in order to control practically all the mass communications media and force every loyal newspaper to slant and falsify the news, and to further incite and at the same time create sympathy for the lawlessness and violence of the Negro mobs. Here is documentary proof of the beginning of their deliberate plot to foment the Negroes into all their lawlessness. Around 1910, one Israel Zangwill wrote a play entitled The Melting Pot. It was sheer propaganda to incite the Negroes and Jews, because the play purportedly visualized how the American people were discriminating against and persecuting Jews and Negroes. At that time, nobody seemed to realize that it was a propaganda play. It was that cleverly written. The propaganda was well wrapped up in the truly great entertainment in the play, and it was a big Broadway hit. Now, in those years, the legendary Diamond Jim Brady used to throw a banquet at the famous Delmonico restaurant in New York after the opening performance of a popular play. He threw such a party for the cast of The Melting Pot, its author, producer, and chosen Broadway celebrities. By then, I'd already made a personal mark on the Broadway theater and was invited to that party. There I met George Bernard Shaw and a Jewish writer named Israel Cohen. Zangwill Shaw and Cohen were the triumvirate who created the Fabian Society in England and had worked closely with a Frankfurt Jew named Mordecai who had changed his name to Karl Marx. But remember, at that time, both Marxism and communism were just emerging, and nobody paid much attention to either, and nobody suspected the propaganda in the writings of those three really brilliant writers. At that banquet, Israel Cohen told me he was then engaged in writing a book which was to be a follow-up on Zangwill's The Melting Pot. The title of his book was to be A Racial Program for the 20th Century. At that time, I was completely absorbed by my work as a playwright, and significant as that title was, its real objective never dawned on me, nor was I interested in reading the book. But it suddenly hit me with the force of a hydrogen bomb when I received a newspaper clipping of an item published by the Washington, D.C. Evening Star in May 1957. That item was a verbatim reprint of the following excerpt in Israel Cohen's book, A Racial Program for the 20th Century, and it reads, as I quote, "We must realize that our party's most powerful weapon is racial tension. By propounding into the consciousness of the dark races that for centuries they have been oppressed by the whites, we can mold them to the program of the Communist Party. In America, we will aim for subtle victory. While inflaming the Negro minority against the whites, we will instill in the whites a guilt complex for their exploitation of the Negroes. We will aid the Negroes to rise to prominence in every walk of life, in the professions and in the world of sports and entertainment. With this prestige, the Negro will be able to intermarry with the whites and begin a process which will deliver America to our cause." That same excerpt was entered into the Congressional Record of June 7, 1957 by Representative Thomas G. Abernathy. Thus, the authenticity of that passage in Cohen's book was fully established. But the one question that remained in my mind was whether it represented the official policy or plot of the Communist Party or just a personal expression of Cohen himself. Hence, I sought more proof, and I found it. In an official pamphlet published in 1935 by the New York Communist Party's official Workers' Library Publishers, that pamphlet was entitled "The Negroes in a Soviet America." It urged the Negroes to rise up, form a Soviet state in the South, and apply for admission to the Soviet Union. It contained a firm pledge that the revolt would be supported by all American Reds and all so-called liberals. On page 38, it promised that a Soviet government would confer greater benefits to Negroes than to whites. And again, this official communist pamphlet pledged that, I quote, "Any act of discrimination or prejudice against a Negro will become a crime under the revolutionary law," unquote. That statement proved that the excerpt in Israel Cohen's book, published in 1913, was an official edict of the Communist Party and directly in line with the Illuminati blueprint for world revolution issued by Weishaupt and later by Albert Pike. Now, there's only one question, and that is to prove that the communist regime is directly controlled by the American Jacob Schiff and London Rothschild masterminds of the Great Conspiracy. A little later, I will provide that proof that will remove even a remote doubt that the Communist Party, as we know it, was created by those masterminds, capitalists, if you will note, that Schiff, the Warburgs, and the Rothschilds planned and financed the entire Russian Revolution, also the murder of the Tsar and his family, and that Lenin, Trotsky, and Stalin took their orders directly from Schiff and the other capitalists whom they supposedly are fighting. Now can you see why the vile Earl Warren and his equally vile co-Supreme Court justices issued that infamous and treasonous desegregation decision in 1954? It was to aid and abet the plot of the Illuminati conspirators to create tension and strife between Negroes and whites.
In public affairs. I'll let you in on something you don't know. I'm one of the few people on the left in Britain who traveled the length and breadth of apartheid South Africa as an underground agent of the African National Congress led by Nelson Mandela, then in Paulsmoor Prison in Cape Town. Therefore, the subject of apartheid is particularly important to me. The question of racism is particularly important to me. And in parenthesis, let me tell you this, that throughout the entirety of my time underground in South Africa under apartheid, every house I slept in, every dinner I ate, every car I drove in was provided by Jewish activists of the African National Congress. So Jews don't have to be on the side of apartheid. They don't have to be on the side of racism. Jewish heroes amongst my blood brotherhood, like Dennis Goldberg.
Taller I become, the farther you take my rights away, the faster I will run. You can deny me, you can decide to turn your face away. No matter, 'cause they're